Thank you, Chairperson. Thank you, Bansi Bhai, and the entire team for inviting me for this talk. I'll be talking on placement of DPP-4 inhibitors in management of diabetes with CVD. And as you know, diabetes is increasingly prevalent and CVD is a leading cause of death in this population. And approximately 1.76 times relative risk of CVD mortality in patients with diabetes, and a lot of deaths in diabetes due to CVD. Now, if you see the spectrum of diabetes, you have a spectrum of diabetes, and along with it are the CVD complications which are associated, and CKD complications which are associated, and all of these cardiorenal complications associated with diabetes increase the CVD risk to a large extent. Now, coming to this ICMR in-depth study, you can see that the diabetes, 101 million patients, and a lot of comorbidities like dysglycemia, hypertension, generalized obesity, abdominal obesity, hypercholesterolemia, and high LDL cholesterol, all associated, which all lead to increased CVD risk. Now, diabetes and CVD is deadly due. It is more worrisome because CVD, CAD is most rapidly increasing in India, and patients less than 40 years of age are involved. So this is young population being involved. 10 to 25% of MIs in India occur before 40 years of age. More than 50% of CVD deaths in India occur before the age of 50 years. As per India Diabetes Study, newly diagnosed Indian type 2 diabetes at a high CVD risk, and 60.5% were classified as very high risk, 82.5% appear to have at least one cholesterol abnormalities, and 96.5% presented with lipid values above recommended targets. Even in younger population, like less than 20 years also, obesity, increased LDL-C is more common. Also, smoking, hypertension, overweight is also very common in population aged less than 40 years, and all of this confers excess risk. So a lot of diabetes patients have NAFLD, have obesity, have CVD like peripheral artery disease, CAD and heart failure. CKD is also very, very common, and therefore we need drugs basically which address cardiometabolic risk and which decrease the risk of future CVD events with the benefits of weight loss and glucose lowering. And we will see the role of DPP-4 here in this spectrum. Now, DPP-4, unsung hero. Now, the limitations of sulfonylureas, pioglitazone, insulin as second-line agents are weight gain, hypoglycemia, poor compliance, and a lacking of durability of action. DPP-4 is a welcome addition to diabetes treatment armamentarium. What I say is DPP-4 is like black trousers. You can wear them for any occasion. They can be combined with any drug. Now, coming to the pathophysiology, in cretins in Asians, it has been seen that the intact GLP levels are considerably low in Japanese, and meal-induced enhancement of GPL secretion is negligible in the Japanese compared to Caucasians. However, intact GLP levels are comparable between non-diabetics and type 2 diabetics, which suggests that we have low GLP-1 levels. This was a study from Dr. A.K. Singh. Now, this is by Dr. Anoop Mishra, which says that the non-obese Indian population with type 2 diabetes, circulating plasma DPP-4 levels are higher on higher side, and they positively correlate with waist to hip ratio, total intra-abdominal adipose volume, liver span, fasting insulins, low density lipoproteins, triceps skin fold, and total intra-abdominal adipose tissue volume. So all of these metabolic markers which confer worse prognosis are associated with increased DPP-4 levels, and therefore this leads to decreased GLP-1, which is detrimental to cardiovascular health. Now the DPP-4 target many pathophysiological defects in the form they increase the insulin synthesis, insulin secretion, they decrease the hepatic glucose output, they have mild effect on insulin, peripheral insulin resistance, and they have more effect on hepatic insulin resistance. They reduce the glucagon secretion, they increase the GLP-1 levels and the GIP levels. So they have all the positive metabolic benefits. So the metabolic benefits may be direct in the form of glucose-dependent insulin secretion and glucose-dependent glucagon suppression. They also inhibit the DPP-4 enzyme, and therefore they increase the intact GLP-1 levels, which again is beneficial on the cardiovascular health. Now, gliptins are effective also if you compare them with the different molecules. They have a good glycemic control, and the glycemic control is better once your HbA1c moves towards 7, the target 7. Now, coming to the CV benefits of gliptins, they decrease the myocardial infarct size, they decrease the triglyceride levels, they increase the left ventricular function, they increase the endothelial function, they decrease inflammation and oxidative stress, and they decrease the atherosclerotic plaque volume. Now, the DPP-4 and ischemic preconditioning in patients of MI, they are shown in some studies to limit the infarct size. There is a GLP-1 activation, which leads to activation of CAMP, which leads to activation of protein kinase KAK, and it leads to the increase in Krebs, the endothelial nitric oxide, the S-lipoxygenase. All of these are beneficial. They decrease the apoptosis, they decrease the myocardial infarct size, and they preserve the myocardial function. And this is done by prevention of degradation of BNP, substance P, NPY, peptide YY, bradykinin, and SD1 alpha. So basically, they are shown in studies to have improvement in the cardiovascular function. The DPP-4 inhibition leads to systolic BP reduction also. In this study, which lasted for around 12 months, it was shown that there is a gradual reduction in blood pressure. The systolic blood pressure is reduced by to the tune of 2 to 3 millimeters of mercury, and the diastolic to the tune of 1 to 2 millimeters, which is a favorable effect. And though the reduction is less, still it translates into good reduction in CVD events like stroke. So these were the various studies done with DPP-4 inhibitors. We'll go into detail the initial studies with allogliptin and saxagliptin were basically very worrisome because they showed increased incidence of hospitalization of heart failure. But TECO studies basically with the sitagliptin established that sitagliptin is cardio-safe. And then the other remarkable studies, the Carolina study and the Carmelina studies, which were recently published, which showed that DPP-4 inhibitors are safe on the cardiovascular front. So the CV outcomes we see by 3-point MACE, which is CV death, non-fatal MI, non-fatal stroke. 4-point MACE we see CV death, non-fatal MI, non-fatal stroke, unstable angina requiring hospitalization. We classify the drug as increasing the CV risk. It is inferior to placebo. CV safety, it is non-inferior to placebo, and CV production, which is superior to placebo. So if you see the short-term CV outcomes of newer anti-diabetic classes, they may be similar among patients starting second-line treatments. So the CV outcomes are compared with GLP-1 receptor agonist, DPP-4, and SGLT2 inhibitors, and the other drugs. It was shown that sulfonylureas and basal insulins were associated with comparatively higher cardiovascular risk when compared to DPP-4 inhibitors. Now, these were the trials done with DPP-4 inhibitors, which have been published, Sevier, Timmy, Examine, TECOS, Carolina and Carmelina. Now the summary of CV outcome trials which were done, pooled analysis of all the 5 available CVOT trials with DPP-4 resulted in a neutral effect on MI stroke and the combined endpoints of MI stroke, CV death and hospitalization for heart failure. So the outcomes were neutral basically. For the primary outcome, most CVOTs fall within the FDA mandated upper 95% confidence limit of 1.3. Hospitalization of heart failure was unfortunately more in the saxagliptin arm in sevier-timid IL, and the allogliptin arm, it was also numerically more. However, in the subsequent trials with sitagliptin with the other agents like linagliptin, this was not shown. So once the patient has propensity for heart failure, it is better not to use saxagliptin or allogliptin. So sitagliptin did not increase the risk of major adverse cardiovascular events, hospitalization for heart failure, or other adverse events. Saxagliptin did not increase or decrease the rate of ischemic events, though the rate of hospitalization for heart failure was increased. Allogliptin did not increase the rates of major adverse cardiovascular events. Vildagliptin was not associated with an increased risk of MACE. So based on all the published CVOT outcome trials, except sitagliptin, all the other gliptins can be considered CV safe. Now, this was the Carmelina trial where the high risk patients with cardiorenal morbidities were taken, and it was concluded that among adults with type 2 diabetes and high CV and renal risk, linagliptin added to usual care compared with placebo added to the usual care resulted in non-fair risk of composite CV outcome over a median of 2.2 years. So it was found to be CV safe. And the same was found in the Carolina trial where it was compared head to head with sulfonylureas. It was found that this drug is absolutely safe on the CV front. So this was a meta-analysis which showed that DPP-4 inhibition did not increase the upper boundary of risk for composite endpoints nor for any individual component by more than 30%. Relative risk were 0.99% confidence in interval for composite, CV specific death, non-fatal MI, non-fatal stroke, and this drug was basically safe. So this meta-analysis provides robust reassurance about the CV safety of DPP-4 inhibitors with regards to individual atherosclerotic events. So effect on DPP-4 inhibitors on renal outcomes in diabetic mellitus systemic review, because renal outcomes are equally important, because if there is a renal deterioration, then CVD events will increase. The rate of change of eGFR was not different in DPP-4 inhibitors and control groups, so it was renal safe. They have very low risk of hypoglycemia with good glycemic control, because if hypoglycemia is more, then again the CV events increase. DPP-4 are weight neutral, and that is another CV benefit basically with DPP-4 inhibitors. As far as the renal and hepatic impairment is concerned, in patients with renal insufficiency, all of the inhibitors can be used in patients with mild renal insufficiency. Patients which are renally eliminated will require dose adjustment, and some of them like linagliptin will not require dose adjustment. In patients with hepatic insufficiency, most of the inhibitors can be used in mild to moderate hepatic insufficiency. However, there is somewhat less data in patients with severe hepatic insufficiency. For vildagliptin, it is contraindicated in patients with hepatic insufficiency. So the ADS standards of care states that the CV effects are neutral for ASCVD as far as the DPP-4 inhibitors are concerned. In heart failure, sexagliptin has a potential risk and should not be used. So basically, glucose-lowering treatment in patients with heart failure and type 2 diabetes, after you have added the drugs like SGLT2, GLP-1 receptor agonists, for additional glucose control, the DPP-4 inhibitors can be safely used. So DPP-4 inhibitors can be given to frail patients, patients with low values of insulin resistance markers, bladder, older patients, patients at high CV renal risk already on SGLT2 therapy, patients with recent type 2 diabetes diagnosed at low CV risk, and patients at high risk of hypoglycemia. So there is a wide frame of patients where this drug can be used. Efficacy is almost comparable basically to SGLT2 inhibitors. It is a complementary mechanism of action with SGLT2 inhibitors. In renal impairment, it is well tolerated, effective. In elderly, well tolerated, effective. Females, well tolerated, effective. In hypertensive patients, also beneficial, and obese patients can be used because it is weight neutral. So the placement therapy is basically in newly diagnosed type 2 diabetes patients without established ASCVD, CKD, heart failure, considering the safety profile, elderly, patients with kidney disease, patient at risk of hypoglycemia, co-action of DPP-4 inhibitors with other drugs such as metformin, SGLT2 inhibitors, and pioglitazone can provide additional glycemic efficacy without increasing the burden of diabetes. So DPP-4 position after metformin, it causes the points for it is HbA1c reduction, similar to other class of drugs, addresses key pathologies of type 2 diabetes, effective in renal impairment, established durability, no increase in hypoglycemia, weight neutral, well tolerated in most patients, no increase in overall or any single type of CV events, in CVOT seen with sitagliptin and linagliptin, experience and evidence. What goes against is safety concerns with some of the members for hospitalization for heart failure. So DPP-4 enzyme, usual role in CV system, important role in the checks and balances of normal physiology, modulates peptide levels which have significant effects on CV physiology. It increased DPP-4 inhibitors reported is not only in hyperglycemia, but also inflammation, hypertension, heart failure and atherosclerotic states. Most studies have, most mechanic studies have suggested that DPP-4 inhibition may beneficially address most of the known severe risk markers, often independent of glycemic lowering. Larger controlled trials, pooled analysis, and real-world evidence continues to support overall CV safety of DPP-4 inhibitors. So to summarize, DPP-4 inhibitors have shown potential cardiovascular benefits beyond glycemic control. These agents protect incretin hormones from degradation, improving insulin secretion and sensitivity. The cardiovascular effects of DPP-4 inhibitors are attributed to both GLP-1-dependent and independent mechanisms. Preclinical and small mechanistic studies suggest DPP-4 inhibitors may have cardioprotective effects, including improved endothelial function, reduced atherosclerosis, and blood pressure lowering. Meta-analysis of clinical trials have demonstrated no increased cardiovascular risk with DPP-4 inhibitors, although a slight increase in heart failure was observed with some drugs. While some studies indicate potential cardiovascular benefits, large-scale outcome trials are ongoing to definitely assess the impact of DPP-4 inhibitors on cardiovascular events in patients with type 2 diabetes. So gliptins are potent and effective, address core defects of diabetes, partner well with conventional therapies, can be administered any time of the day, meal independent, no excess risk of hypoglycemia, so it is a safe choice, no weight gain. Almost all of them can be safely administered in any degree of renal impairment, although dose adjustment may be required with some agents. Overall CV safe as seen in COTs. DPP-4 differ in their pharmacokinetic profiles. However, all DPP-4 inhibitors have demonstrated nearly same efficacy at recommended therapeutic dosage. DPP-4 inhibitors are valuable and safe investments in managing type 2 diabetes patients and can be placed safely in CV patients. Thank you.